Welcome to Low-sal-life. I'm Sarah, and on this channel we talk about salicylate sensitivity. So it's been a little bit of a challenging week. We've had a lot of wildfires. I live in rural eastern Washington, and there's been a lot of fires. And then, of course, with Western America in flames, there's been a lot of smoke. So I've been actually have really low energy today. The smoke has definitely moved in. We're in the in between the very unhealthy to the hazardous levels. So definitely way too much smoke in the air. If you've met me through the Salicylate forums, right, you may have heard that I've had some of my worst reactions that have been smoke related. One of them was around a campfire. It was a bad day. I did have some Thai food that day and a glass of wine, but I ended up getting very lightheaded. I just about passed out and I threw up in my tent, which is a good time. But the moral of the story is don't burn wood with, you know, like birch wood or willows or woods with salicylates in their bark, because you can still inhale that. And for me, my reactions are the worst for inhalation. Even though it's very rare that I have inhale salicylates, it's just kind of, when it gets really smoky, besides it just being hazardous because it's smoke, I think that it affects me a little bit differently than the average person, because you think about all of those salicylates going in the air. Today's video is only going to cover this section. And while I could read it to you and be done in about 2 minutes, this article is available online, but we'll go through it and I'll even make some pictures for you guys and everything, so it'll be a little bit easier to understand. So this article is titled Frequency of Reactions to Foods Containing Natural Salicylates in Aspirin Sensitive Patients. The PI on it is Rena George, and there are co-PIs Michael Zachariasen and Kling Kelly. This is a little bit different, so I always talk about what original research is, right? Peer-reviewed original research is like the golden nugget in all of research, right? You have scientists who are doing a science project, right? Essentially, they have a question, they're trying to figure out how to solve it. So they do an experiment and then they report out on their results, whether or not it was successful or not, whether or not it fit their hypothesis or not. And so then it goes through a peer review process where they explain their methods and other scientists will say, yeah, that seems possible, plausible, or that seems like you made a mistake somewhere in your method, you should go back, do it again, and then we'll say that, you know, it's good enough research for publication. Then it gets published in research articles. Most of the articles that I try and find will be peer-reviewed original research. If it's not, I will let you know. In this case, it is original research. They did do their science experiment, right? They did a participant study. This one was done by phone. To my knowledge, I didn't see if this ever became a peer-reviewed article. It's from 2000. It's a little bit on the old side. I couldn't really find very much information on it. This here is a conference summary. And so what happens is you have experts from all over the world or the nation get together for a conference that's held by a really great organization. So in this case, it was done by AAAI, the American Academy of Allergy, Asthma, and Immunology. Very reputable group. Their conference summaries, the one that I have here, was published in the Journal of Allergy and Clinical Immunology. So great journal. You know, they'll have a conference. All of the people that have been studying for that year will report out on their findings. Sometimes they go into the peer review process, sometimes they don't. Again, I put all the research articles at lowsallife.com/research. So, and then they're also separated by kind of by symptom. So in the last video, we kind of talked about, there's kind of an order of things that we do. We want to know who the investigator was, why they were interested in it. Sometimes it gives us a little bit of insight, right? Who the participants were, what their method was, what the findings were, And then, of course, what the discussion is and any concerns that you have about the study. So the WHO is Dr. Rena George, and she is she works in immunology. In this case, she was at the Medical College of Wisconsin. I'm not sure if she's there now, but this was 20 years ago. The question that they had was, is it possible that people with aspirin allergy also have other symptoms that are probably being caused by naturally occurring salicylates? If you're new here, salicylates are a natural food, a natural compound that's basically an aspirin that's natural in foods, healthy foods. It can also be in cosmetics and things that we breathe in. In this case, they were looking specifically at mostly fruits. I don't think there were any vegetables in it. So they wanted to see, they did a telephone survey, and they ended up looking in their medical charts, right, for patients who had aspirin allergy and other symptoms. The second thing they were looking at is the frequency of symptoms that they might have from these natural foods that contained natural aspirins. They ended up picking out 34 subjects or patients, and they were basically, they had to have aspirin allergy and then also one of the other two symptoms that was induced from their aspirin reaction. So in their charts, they would have seen, like, maybe on the same day that they took an aspirin and they ended up with, and the two symptoms were asthma or urticaria, which is basically hives or like red, like a rash, swelling, bumpy skin, right? So asthma, allergy, and urticaria with aspirin. So they called the 34 patients, enrolled them in the study, right, and did a telephone survey. They basically asked if they have ever had reactions to the following foods. And I'll read them to you because there's a lot of them. Almonds, apples, apricots, blackberries, boysenberries, cherries, currants, dewberries, gooseberries, grapes or raisins, nectarines, oranges, peaches, plums, prunes, raspberries, strawberries, cucumbers, pickles, and tomatoes. If you're new to salicylate sensitivity, that basically is all the high, a lot of the high, high foods to avoid. There's plenty more, but this already seems long enough. Then after they questioned them about the foods that they've reacted to or did not react to, they then classified the ones with symptoms by a couple different categories. So the first one was respiratory symptoms. So that included asthma, anything like shortness of breath, wheezing, coughing. Coughing and chest tightness. The second symptom, I'm all itchy. Just talking about hives makes me itchy. Okay, so the second set of symptoms was urticaria. So rash, hives, swelling on the skin, you know, anything itchy, super itchy. The third one was throat tightness, tingling or swelling, like in the mouth. They did ask about oral allergy syndrome. For anybody that doesn't know what that is when you're allergic to, like, birch. I'm familiar with birch quite a bit. If you have birch oral allergy syndrome, that might be like your only true allergy, but like, especially during birch season, you could also have issues eating certain foods. So eating apples or carrots or almonds, banana, I think is also involved in that, possibly. So if you have a birch allergy, you could also have inflammation. Hazelnuts is another one, to those foods, especially during pollination. You can have it year round, but it gets really, really bad during when the birches are pollinating. So oral allergy syndrome is one of those, and you get hives or kind of dry, kind of mouth reactions, right? Blisters in your mouth. Number five was other symptoms, you know, headache, fatigue, you know, anything like that, didn't fall into the other categories. And the sixth one was asymptomatic. So if the patients just didn't have any symptoms when they ate any foods. This is where it gets a little bit interesting. Of the 34 patients that participated in the study, 45% of them had a reaction to one of those foods. A lot of patients actually reported many of those foods. 55% of the patients said that they didn't have any reactions, so that's good, right? They were asymptomatic. Group one, so this is the respiratory symptoms group. There were five patients that reported, yes, when I eat these foods, I get an asthma attack or wheezing or cough or shortness of breath. There were three of them that reacted to cherries, two to grapes or raisins, two to tomato, two to apricots, two to strawberries, and one to orange. In group two, there were patients, there were two patients, 13%, with the hives, the urticaria, and they reacted to strawberries, two, oranges, one, and or tomatoes, one. In group three, this was the group with the tingling in their mouth or their throat swelling up or just swelling and kind of blisters. Group three included three patients, 20% of the group, who developed throat symptoms after ingesting almonds. Group four consisted of three patients who experienced oral allergy syndrome after eating a tomato. Two from tomato, one from peaches, and one from strawberries, one from pickles, one from oranges, and one from raspberries. It's kind of a mixed bag there. Group five consisted of two patients with non-specific symptoms, generally ill-feeling, facial flushing related to apricot and tomato. I totally have flushing. Like, I get hot flashes. Like, I had them check my hormones so much over the last... So I went low-sal 3 years ago, and... you know, basically between like 32 and 35, I had them do like so many like premenopausal, blood tests. You're like, are you sure that I'm not going through menopause? Because like, this is brutal. I do have a friend, her mom went through menopause in her, I think, mid 30s, maybe early 30s, and they couldn't figure out what was wrong with her. And then they finally figured out when she was well through it that she was menopausal. So I was like, hey, you know, I have all these medical issues. It wouldn't surprise me if I started early. But it ended up just being from salicylates. And so now that I don't eat them, I don't have hot flashes. It's amazing. Anyway, so this group five, two patients, general ill feeling or facial flushing, and they reacted to, one reacted to apricot and the other to tomato. And then the rest of the group we already mentioned, 55%, was asymptomatic. That was group six. The last little bit that, you know, that discussion, right? This is just a conference paper, so it doesn't go into a lot of discussion or what they kind of wish they would have been able to do. There is one statement that I'll mention in a second, but it does say that no patient reported symptoms with apples, nectarines, plums, prunes, or other types of berries. Berries are actually quite high. I don't know, you know, it's kind of interesting why those are so low. It's possible that, you know, maybe berries aren't, you know, as accessible to some people. They're really expensive and you don't eat a lot at a time, so maybe that could have something to do with it. It did say that most patients were not familiar with dewberries, gooseberries, or boysenberries. I think that that's really funny because when I've looked at the low-sal lists, you know, by Swain and these Australian reports, and it's like, yeah, I didn't really know what gooseberries or dewberries were. Like, I always have to look up what they are, so I think it's really funny that some people didn't know what they were. At the end of the paragraph, the summary, they mentioned that their survey concludes that it is possible that many aspirin-sensitive individuals have adverse reactions to food that contain natural salicylates, and the skin testing and double-blind placebo-controlled food challenges may be useful in the patient population. So now we've talked about who, what they did, what the results were, and now we go on to discussion. And I'm going to have to provide that for you. You know, this is a pretty simple, straightforward discussion. Basically, the point of the study is just to say that, hey, we should look at people that have aspirin sensitivity, aspirin allergy. It's not a true allergy, but if they have allergic type reactions like asthma or hives, then we should look into, maybe there might be some other foods that are causing these type of reactions. That's what the study says, is we did some preliminary data. Let's go and do some more research. Now we talk about limitations of the study. Okay, so first of all, the study, again, it's a very small sample size. There were only 34 participants. You know, that's okay. That's how a lot of these food studies are. So N equals 34 is better than N equals 1, which is, you know, what I'm dealing with over here, me and my body. The second issue is that it was patient-generated data, right? It's not like they were given, obviously it says that this is just like a feasibility study. It wasn't actually, they didn't do like a placebo and a double-blind study or anything like that. But the patients participated and offered their examples. You know, we don't know if they ate something else with those foods, you know, so they weren't just testing one food. It's just, you know, they, after they have a reaction, they're going to think about what they ate recently. And, you know, it might be strawberries, but they might have had whipped cream with that. And, you know, it might have been with a pie crust or, you know, shortbread or something like that. So, you know, patient-generated answers are usually not as reliable as other ways of testing. So that's a second concern. The third issue is that it wasn't a double-blind study with a placebo. So those, of course, are always issues. Those are the best kind of studies. From a salicylate perspective, I would have liked to have seen other foods besides fruits. They had pickles. Technically, a cucumber is still a fruit, but, you know, other things that are not actually literally botanically fruits. So get some leaves in there, get some roots, get some other, stems, right? Like, ask some of those questions. It would have probably also been a good idea to ask some low salicylate foods that are on there. You know, did they have reactions to pears, right? Peeled pears. Have they ever had reactions to celery? You know, some of those types of things. I think that would have, because they could just be reactive to food, right? Certain foods, not necessarily to anything like that. And then the last thing that I'll mention, and they did address it in the study, of course, is the patient generated, not actually participating in a real physical study. They did not eliminate IgE allergy tests for these patients. So, for the people that reacted to cherry, they didn't say, have you ever had an allergy test positive, like a skin prick test, an IgE test that says that you're allergic to cherry. They probably would have said no, but what if they said yes? Then that would kind of blow their thing, right? Because in that case, they could have aspirin allergy and they could also have cherry allergy. So that's something else to think about. And of course, they address that. I think that's it. That is all. If you have any questions, if you have any information for a research article that goes with this, like I said, this is basically like a feasibility study. To see if it can launch into something, more structured and regulated. So if you have any information on that, that would be great. Leave any questions or comments down below. Oh, I forgot to say, if you want to find me on Instagram or Facebook, I spend a lot of time mostly on Instagram. You can find me low-sal-life. And you can also find, I have a website where I drop all this research and also solicit food lists based on original research, and that is at lowsallife.com. Thanks. See you next week.